Well, good afternoon, evening, and morning, everybody. Nice to see you all. Today we've only got two speakers today, but that's all right because both of them are really good. But it might mean we might finish a bit early. And the sort of parish news, we had a very good meeting in Stowe Market. In-person meeting seems like a long time ago, but it was only last week. But we had a nice get together last Saturday it was, and we will be having another in-person meeting, we hope, in the autumn. In the meantime, our next Zoom meeting is 19th of May, and what we're doing for that one, for the whole of the session, we're going to carry on with the thing that Steve Gardam started at the last Zoom meeting, the same song, different song idea. Because Steve didn't get past the child balance, he needed to get on to other things. But we're going to have the whole hour and a half talking about that kind of thing, how you compare songs and so on. Which, of course, I will find fascinating. I don't know whether the rest of you will, but it'll be good. Then that's May the 19th. Then June the 16th will be our last of these Zoom meetings for this season. I still have a slot available for June the 16th if anybody wants to volunteer or volunteer somebody else. And of course, we have our major conference in July, the 20th, 21st in London, Shire House. Take off, it's called Collector Mania, talking about the collectors and their worlds, collectors past and present. There's still a couple of days left if anybody wants to put in a proposal for a paper. Although we do already have enough for the 2 day conference. But if anybody's burning to put something in, get it into me within the next couple of days. So that's 20th, 21st of July in London. One other piece of news, the Vaughan Williams Library is launching their new website, search engine, this coming week. I think tomorrow, I think on Monday. And that will be my, will include my indexes and how to use my indexes and new search engine, which is easier to use for beginners and people who don't use the site that often. I believe that what will happen is that you go to the same old site, vwml.org. And then you'll have the new site there, but you'll have the choice of using the old one if you can't face anything new. But of course, the new will eventually replace the old, so you should get used to the new. And please do test it out. Please test my indexes to see if it's better. It should be better. And Malcolm and Elena here, of course, they could have told me all of this. Am I getting it right, Malcolm? I can see you on the screen. Yes, he's nodding. Please.
Yeah, that's all correct, Steve. Yeah, and
Good.
I would encourage people, although the old one's still there, to test the new one. Do let us know if you're having difficulties, if you're not finding the results you're expecting, anything odd. Just there's a link on the site to report anything that's a bit odd. Thanks.
Yeah, so please do that because it's one of our major resources. Okay, so we're going to go on now to Brian, who's going to continue with his analysis or discussion of the them radical singers and songwriters. So Brian, are you ready? Yep, over to you. We tested his thing about 2 minutes ago, so it should still work.
Okay.
Did you share sound?
I have shared sound.
Good, right.
And you should be able to see. Oh,
Yeah,
it's not
that's
my
good.
first slide, unfortunately, because I'm right. There we go. There's my opening slide. Are we ready to rock?
Yes.
Right, well, welcome everybody. Nice to see you all. I'm giving the second part of my talk on songwriting in Lancashire during the early stages of the Industrial Revolution. And some of you will have seen my presentation last month about the radical songwriter John Stafford. So I'm going to go again to my same locator map. There's Lancashire located within England. And here's a slightly closer view of Lancashire from a kind of map from the period I'm talking about. And now we're going to narrow it down to the precise area. You can see there the great city of Manchester, Cottonopolis, and up there to the northeast is the town of Oldham, which we're going to be talking about a little bit today. So, as I say, Manchester was the great centre of the cotton industry, and weaving of cotton had been going on in Lancashire since the 17th century. And by the late 18th century, they developed this system called putting out, by which merchants who were based mostly in urban centres would provide weavers who were working at handlooms in a domestic setting in the outlying towns with the raw materials from which they could produce cloth and which were paid for on completion. And here's a picture of a handloom weaver at his loom. The mechanization of the spinning process had been more or less completed towards the end of the 18th century, and through Hargreaves' spinning jenny, Arkwright's water frame, finally Crompton's mule, and this led to huge spinning mills being built in Manchester by the late 1790s. I showed you this slide before, but here's one of those great mills along the side of the Rochdale Canal in the Ancoats district of the city. And these mills greatly increased the production of yarn, but the early attempts to mechanize the weaving process were mostly unsuccessful, and that resulted in a glut of work for those handloom weavers. And this in turn resulted in mass migration from the countryside into Lancashire cotton towns like Oldham, Bolton, and Rochdale, which saw a doubling of their populations. The period between 1788 and 1803 has been described, not entirely accurately, as the golden age of weaving. Wages were, at least for part of that time, pretty good, and there was the autonomy of working from home, which gave the weavers a sense of control over their lives and from which they developed a strong spirit of independence. So what kind of songs did these people sing? We've got several sources of evidence, many of which date from a little later, but are probably representative. The Lancashire dialect poet Edwin Waugh published a series of sketches in prose of rural life in the county based on rambles he'd made in the late 1840s. And these included some valuable information about song and music. He reported the singing of songs, including several we might recognise as folk, such as Give Me the Punch Ladle, Lord Marlborough, and High Germany, along with other popular pieces of the day, and what he called a few rough humorous songs in the Lancashire dialect. John Page, describing the street traders of Manchester under the alias Felix Folio, wrote of ballad sheets pinned to walls and being read avidly by the populace, noting that local tastes favoured songs about the hated Napoleon Bonaparte and the weaving trade rather than the pastoral ballads that were more popular in the south of the country. The weaving songs, he said, were profusely interspersed with some in the native dialogue. The popularity of Lancashire dialect as a written form had been pioneered by Tim Bobbin, nom de plume of a teacher called John Collier, originally a weaver in Hyde, but later a schoolmaster in Milne Row near Rochdale. His Tummus and Mary, published in 1746, was popular locally, although some criticised its crude and brutal humour and others the accuracy of its dialect, while the later dialect poet Ben Brierley sniffed that he had had to strive to rescue the Lancashire character from the erroneous conceptions of Tim Bobbin. Tummus and Mary led to more political prose in dialect, such as the work of Robert Walker, a handloom weaver born near Ashton in 1728, who styled himself Tim Bobbin II. Walker used local vernacular to express his strongly radical political opinions in his book Plebeian Politics in 1802. But the most important chronicler of Lancashire verse in the 19th century was John Harland. a senior reporter on the Manchester Guardian, Harlan published several books and newspaper columns on local songs and customs. His most significant work, revised and published after his work by Thomas Wilkinson, was Ballads and Songs of Lancashire, Ancient and Modern. This was a quite eclectic collection, which included a lot of antique literary verse, as well as the works of various contemporary dialect poets. But the section that has exercised most historians who've analysed it subsequently has been that concerning local compositions of the early 19th century. Some of these were sourced from oral performance through Harlan's friend, the local historian John Higson, while others were copied from broadsides with which Harlan filled a scrapbook. And there it is, you can see it in Manchester Central Library if you ask nicely. One ballad that particularly fascinated Harlan was a dialect piece of which he believed, I quote, more copies to have been sold among the rural population of Lancashire than of any other song known. This was John of Grinfilt, John of Greenfield in standard English, Greenfield being a village 5 miles to the east of Oldham. The song appeared on broadsides from many of the main printers in Lancashire. Here are a couple from Harlan's own collection. The song mixed patriotism, comedy, and social comment, centering around the determination of its eponymous hero to sign up for the war against the French in the simple-minded countryman's belief that Oldham, where actually the real-life recruiting office was situated, was an exotic, faraway place where he would actually get to grips with the enemy. So here are the first two verses of John of Grinfilt, sung by Sid Calderbank, who I should point out at this point is an expert on Lancashire dialect, as many of you will know, an expert on the John of Grinfilt ballads, and he's given me an enormous amount of help with this section of the talk. I tell you, Sid's work on John of Grinfilt will put many an academic to shame.
Says John to his wife on hot summer's day, I'm resolved in Grinfilt no longer to stay. So I scoot to Oudham as fast as I can, so it's fair the wheel, Grinfilt, and fair the wheel, and for a sodger I be, a brave Oudham I see, and I step me a battle with French. Hey, John, says her nannan, who bitterly cried, wilt be one at foot, or else thou meanst to ride, odd zens, wench, I'd ride either ass or a mule or addle cabri, Grinfilt, as blackest old jewel, both clemming and starving, we never have fired the little welly drive any mon mad.
Part of Joan's motivation for joining up is the line you just heard, in which she says that clemming and starving with never a farthing would drive any man mad, clemming in the dialect meaning essentially the same as starving. At another point, Joan declares to his wife Nan that there's been 2 days this week we'd had nought to eat at all, accurately reporting the widespread hunger in rural Lancashire at the time. The song was most probably written during the late 1790s, at which point, despite the so-called golden age, the manufacturers were driving down the wages of the handloom weavers to the point of real hardship. The weavers' discontent had not, at this point, turned to political radicalism, and the prevailing mood of the ballad was discontented but essentially loyalist, as encapsulated by Joan's bellicose outbursts like, first Frenchman I find, I'll tell him in mind, and if he'll not fight, he shall run. This is England football hooliganism speak. John of Grinfilt had a known author. Joseph Lees of the outlying village of Glodwick, pronounced Glodick locally. He was himself a handloom weaver and experienced in the hardships of the trade, but he was also a part-time schoolmaster, literate and able to produce a manuscript copy from which he would sing the ballad at parties. He later had multiple copies printed, which he would sell from his house, and the song was later reproduced by several local printers. Although the broadsides specify no tune, Joan was clearly composed to be sung to the melody of The Chapter of Kings, a comic song of the 18th century, which had this distinctive six-line stanza structure recognisable in most of the offshoot ballads of Joan and many other songs of the period. That's what you just heard Sid singing. A large part of the ballad's popularity seems to have stemmed from the performances by Joseph Lee's friend Joshua Coop, who, according to one account, was a barber, tooth drawer, bloodletter, warper, spinner, carder, twiner, stubber, and rhymester residing at Oldham. Coop, partly disabled by a withered leg, was an engaging character with a ready wit, a flair for mimicry, and a mastery of the local dialect. And his performances at country wakes and fairs became famous throughout South-East Lancashire. Samuel Bamford, the writer and sometime political radical, gave an eyewitness account of Coop selling printed copies of the ballad on the streets of Manchester, which were apparently almost torn out of his hands by an eager crowd. Bamford was later persuaded by Coop that he had authored Joan, jointly with Joseph Lees, in an attempt to raise money for drink as they sheltered penniless under a hedge from the rain. But although this account was sufficiently colourful to be repeated verbatim by Harland, it seems to have been no more true than Coop's regular claim when performing the ballad in pubs that he himself was the actual Jonah Grinfilt. The character of Joan became so well known that a series of ballads featuring his exploits appeared in short order. In some, such as the ones you see here, Loyal Joan and John O'Grinfield's Return, the patriotic spirit of the hero was emphasised with ever more belligerent threats towards the French and their allies. By the time of the Crimean War, 50 years later, another ballad had Joan setting out to fight the Russians. All of these featured the characters of Joan, his wife Nan, and his aunt Margaret, and all retained that unusual stanza structure. But the most successful follow-up ballad was the one Harland described as John O'Grinfilt Jr., although this title did not appear on any broadside, on which it was most commonly printed under the same name as the original, to the confusion of some subsequent analysts. It was also printed as The Poor Cotton Weaver, and that is the title I'm going to use for the rest of this talk. This was a very different piece to the original John O'Grinfilt. It was written in dialect, in the first person. Margaret had somehow morphed into Joan's wife, the character of Nan having been edited out. And although there are passages with a comic aspect, the mood is much darker, with an emphasis on poverty and starvation and no military tub thumping. From the stanza structure, we can assume that the chapter of King's Tune was retained for this one. Let's hear a little bit of our friend Laura Smith.
I'm a poor cotton weaver, as many men knows. I've now to eat and I've worn out me clothes. You'd hardly give sixpence for all I've got on. Me clocks, they are broken, and stockings I've none. You'd think it were hard to be sent into world, to clem and do best that you can. Our church parson, he kept telling us long, we'd have better times if we'd hold in our tongue. I've held in me tongue till I cannot draw breath. I think that he meant for to clem me to death. I know he lives well by backbiting the devil, and he's never picked or in his life.
So the narrative here is of a starving handloom weaver. You'll hear that again in this one, he was talking about being clemmed to death. Most of his household goods have been confiscated by the bailiff, Biller Bent, and thugs sent by a second bailiff, Biller Dans, arrived to find John and his wife left with only a single stool to sit on, and this they literally pull from under them. This kind of thing did really happen. A dispute with the rapacious cotton master, who refuses to pay John for his work, increases the despair, and the ballad ends with his wife declaring that she should travel to London to petition the Prime Minister if only she had some respectable clothing to wear. Her bitterness is vividly expressed by the line stating that she'd fight those in power with blood up to the een, blood up to the eyes. But the radicalism in the ballad had its limits, because she also stated firmly that she'd nout again king, nothing against the king, despite her sense of injustice. The Poor Cotton Weaver was just as popular with the public as Joseph Lee's original ballad had been. John Harland provided a text taken down by his friend, the local historian John Higson, from the singing of an old handloom weaver at Droylesden, very close to Ashton. According to Harland, the ballad was still a favourite in many parts of Lancashire, and the last three lines had become household words. Writing of his own experiences in Lancashire during the 1840s, Edwin Waugh quoted those same three final lines. Who's not against king, but who likes a fair thing, and who says, who can tell when who's hurt, who, for the purposes of Lancashire dialect, actually means she. And Waugh also spoke of local people speaking fiercely of kings and statesmen with kindling fury in their breasts. In Mary Barton, her 1848 novel describing the poverty of Lancashire cotton workers, Elizabeth Gaskell incorporated a text of the same song, which she retitled The Oldham Weaver, to the confusion of subsequent academics, and she believed that it would represent the authentic voice of the local working class. But several critics have pointed out that although she was wishing to convey accurately the desperate plight of the people, she watered down the message of the ballad a lot by omitting some of the verses that were most critical of authority. And she even removed that threat by Joan's wife to fight with blood at Thien, replacing it with an acquiescent pledge to sew up her own mouth and eyes instead. At this point, some of you may be experiencing a sense of déjà vu, hearing lines such as, I'm a poor cotton weaver as many as one knows, and it'll fate him with blood up to Thien, and this is why it might ring a bell.
I'm a poor weaver as many a one knows. I've no day, and I've wore out me clothes. Me clogs are both broken and stockings I've none. That hardly give me tuppence for all I've gotten on. Old Billy at Bent, he kept telling me long. We met her better times if I'd not but owed me tongue. Well, I've held me tongue till I near lost me breath, and I feel in me heart that I'll soon clam to death.
Now, Hugh McColl claimed to have collected the song he called The Forloom Weaver in 1947 from Beckett Whitehead, who lived in Delph on the Lancashire-Yorkshire border, and who McColl described as a former powerloom weaver whose father had been a Chartist. The normally sensible historian Martha Vicinas was clearly excited that a starker and harsher version than any printed in the 19th century had been extant so recently, and commented, oops, I didn't mean to do that. Where's Ewan gone? There's Ewan. She commented that 150 years of oral circulation had changed it into a song much closer in form and emotion to a traditional ballad. It clearly hadn't occurred to her that McColl, an aficionado of traditional balladry, might just have recast it in that form himself. But the extensive and deliberate editing, the cutting and pasting of phrases, and the adoption of a soaring melody in the Dorian mode so beloved of McColl were a dead giveaway. Beckett Whitehead, about whom McColl got several facts wrong, was actually an autodidact and an expert in Lancashire dialects, so the most likely explanation is that he directed McColl to a printed copy of The Poor Cotton Weaver. Like its patriotic predecessor, The Poor Cotton Weaver spun off several ballads on a similar theme, but these were focused on social justice and protest. Some simply highlighted poverty, like these two on the screen, but at least three others took up the theme of petitioning the great and the good, a mission now to be undertaken by Joan himself rather than his wife. John and Grinfilt's Journey to See the King, made by a Liverpool printer, describes Joan's intention to pursue George IV himself to Ireland during a royal visit that took place in 1821 in order to call on his compassion. I'll tell thee what, Margaret, I mean for to do. I'll tell him I canna get porridge in you. Then I shall hear if he knows our poor state. But how should he, who's hemmed in by the great? It's my inclination to mention taxation and tell him how poor folk are clemmed. But you'll notice that the monarch was not held to blame there for the plight of his subjects. During the 1840s, the theme of an appeal to those in power was revived in broadsides titled John o' Grinfilt's Visit to Mr. Fielden, with a petition to the Queen to fill every hungry belly. In that, Joan asks the old MP John Fielden for an introduction to the Prime Minister, Sir Robert Peel, and his sidekick, the Duke of Wellington, who are referred to as Bob and Nosey in the ballad. A sequel produced shortly afterwards described the imagined outcome of our hero's trip. Arriving in the metropolis, he secures a meeting with Peel, but despite his bowing and scraping, his complaint about the bread tax is brushed aside. Then Peel said, "Joan, those laws, they are good. If by the poor folk they were right understood. By gum, it's a lie, but I think you do joke, unless that you wants my guts to provoke, for it makes me head work and my belly to ache, for to hear you tell such a tale." And Joan returns home in despair, resigned to suffer in silence rather than contemplate any more radical action. A number of historians have deplored the John of Grinfilt ballads as grist to the mill. E.P. Thompson noted in The Making of the English Working Class that it captured the weaver's authentic experience far better than most other working class poetry of the period. Patrick Joyce in Visions of the People described it as a searing indictment of the weaver's conditions, while Martha Vicinus dubbed Joan the most famous figure of protest in Lancashire during the 19th century. But none of them made explicit the fairly obvious point that these were thematically distinct narratives composed by different authors to promote deeply contrasting agendas, most obviously either patriotism and military recruitment or social and political reform, but also including, in later versions on the John template, teetotalism and a reactionary protest against the disestablishment of the Church of Ireland. Joan had become a Lancastrian everyman, and although the original ballad was composed by an individual weaver, most of the later ones were probably written for purely commercial or propaganda reasons. The character of Joan had clearly captured public imagination in Lancashire and beyond, and his name kept on cropping up in broadsides that were not composed on the traditional template of the Chapter of Kings. One depicted Joan comparing notes with a mythical leader of contemporary rural riots, Captain Swing. This was plainly designed to be sung to the tune The King of the Cannibal Islands instead of the Chapter of Kings. Another featured a conversation between the Lancastrian hero and Earl Grey about the passage of the 1832 Reform Bill. But the most successful songs featuring a protagonist clearly descended from John of Grinfilt were those written in Manchester by the Wilson family, to whom I'm going to devote what's left of my time. John Harlan published in the Manchester Guardian in 1839 an article entitled Working Class Poetry, which included two unattributed songs centred around a character called Johnny Green. The article received an indignant riposte in a subsequent issue of the same newspaper from one Alexander Wilson, who expressed astonishment that such an expert should have been unaware that the Johnny Green songs were his own compositions. Alexander decided to publish them in a slim volume entitled Songs of the Wilsons, while Harland eventually made amends by publishing his own book with the same title, extolling the virtues of the family's songs. Harland's book explained the family's history. Charles Wilson, a handloom weaver, had moved during the 18th century from Scotland to Manchester, where his son Michael set up a furniture business in Long Millgate, close to Chetham's College, and that flourished during the early 1800s. Michael was known as a Jacobin, a name derived from the French revolutionaries of 1789, which was applied to English radicals during this period. He was said to have expressed the kind of political opinions that could have got him arrested. He was also a composer of songs, but apparently never wrote down any of them, so they were preserved only as fragments in the memory of his son, Alexander. One of Michael Wilson's songs, The Chapter of Foes, which used our old friend The Chapter of Kings as its template, was a patriotic piece in support of the war effort. However, his composition, Peterloo Massacre, took the radical side unequivocally, marrying a graphic account of the slaughter with a chorus offering sarcastic praise of the yeomanry who had attacked the peaceable and defenceless crowd of protesters. The lyric was in dialect, and the tune specified was the well-known Gee Up Neddy. Mr. Hunt came forward and spoke a few words, when the Peterloo cut their throats, shaking their swords. And thought sure enough they were running their rigs, till I seed more than a 20 lay bleeding like pigs. For the gentlemen cavalry cut down them cleverly, real royal yeomanry, cavalry brave. A commentator in 1906 claimed that he had often heard this sung by old folks, so it clearly had considerable local currency. Alexander Wilson included in Songs of the Wilsons several of his father's more light-hearted pieces, but expressed regret that his more political material had been almost entirely lost. Of the lighter pieces, one bore a significant title, Jones' Ramble for Odom de Carcy Moor Races. Although not written according to the musical template of John and Grinfilt, the title and the use of dialect clearly shows the influence of that most popular ballad. Michael Wilson's son Alexander was the most successful songwriter of the family and was also distinguished as an artist. His painting of Long Millgate, which is there and it's absolutely wonderful, is full of detail and it's been used to illustrate many historical accounts dealing with the period. In his songs, all written in dialect, Alexander reinvented the Lancashire everyman, John of Grinfilt, as Johnny Green, who was still living in Oldham with his wife, Nan, but the old musical template was ignored. Johnny was the protagonist of several colourful days out. Johnny Green's wedding, which incorporated an inebriated stroll through Chatham's College, a visit to Tinker's Gardens, the local Vauxhall pleasure garden, a trip to see a hot air balloon, an outing to the newly opened Liverpool and Manchester Railway. All of these probably used the tune Alexander specified for his balloon song, The Rakes of Mellor, which is no doubt the tune that we know as The Rakes of Mallow. Here's a verse of the balloon song. Today at noon for loom I went on Maister Green's balloon intent. The loosened cords and up he went. It really were delighting. I couldn't have gone what felly meant, for as soon as e'er he made ascent, he seemed as up to sky he bent and up to moon a fighting. Although Alexander's songs were generally comic in tone, his radical sympathies occasionally surfaced. Johnny Green's wedding was basically a romp. We dance like Morris dancers done. But listen to what he slips into this stanza, apparently about a fearsome beetle observed in the Chetham's Museum. We see the clock case first, good laws, where death stands up with great long claws. His legs and wings and lantern jaws, they really look quite fearing. They're snakes and washbills just like pikes, but humped and out reforming tykes. And thee and me and Sam and Mike's once took a blanket earring. The lyric references the great radical orator Henry Hunt, who was arrested at Peterloo, also the reform movement and the Blanketeers protest march in 1817, and made it clear that the writer and his brother, who was Summer Mikes, were participants in that movement and had actually carried their pikes to the demonstrations. Another line in the song describes his discomfort at the display of the great long swords that remind him of the weapons used by the troopers at Peterloo. Alexander's songs were obviously popular. Both Edwin Waugh and Felix Folio cited Johnny Green's wedding as an example of the dialect songs that were common in Lancashire during their day. The key to their success may have lain in Alexander's gift for self-promotion. He described an incident in which he had leapt from his father's furniture shop on Long Millgate to show a copy of Johnny Green's wedding to a performing artist, Mr. Gates, who happened to be passing by and who went on to sing it during the whole of the season with applause. Clearly, stage performance proved an excellent advertisement for the broadsides of the song. Alexander was also a regular at meetings of writers that took place at the Sun Inn near to his home. Where's the Sun Inn? Here it is. Which became known as Poet's Corner. Although the majority of the participants wrote in the high-flown style of the Romantic poets and rather despised the local vernacular, Alexander was nonetheless welcomed and himself wrote a descriptive poem naming many of the attendees at one such meeting. Alexander's brother Thomas was also a prolific songwriter, but the 30 or more songs he is believed to have composed, many of them about the Napoleonic Wars, were mostly lost. The book into which they had been transcribed, I quote, was lent to a low comedian and never recovered. A few other examples of local songwriting can be identified from this period in the area to the east of Manchester. Harland mentioned several, based mostly on the evidence of his friend John Higson, who had collected several songs himself from oral performances. One was Gorton Town, apparently composed by John Beswick, alias Parish Jack, a singer, a fluter, and a fiddler, who is in demand at stirs and merrymakings where his vocal and instrumental services were often paid in kind. Beswick's was apparently printed as a broadside, though no copy has survived. From Higson too came Grimshaw's Factory Fire, a song describing the arson attack on an early mill that utilised power looms and that was built in Manchester in 1790. This was composed by an illiterate handloom weaver named Lucas, who was famed locally for his poetry. Again, the broadside copies that were reputedly printed and sold in Manchester were all lost, and all that remained was a fragment gleaned from the various recollections of five old men who had once sung it. Harland believed that it represented the true feelings of the working class at the time. Higson's star performer was Common John Grimshaw of Gorton, 4 miles or so east of Manchester, who provided Harland with three songs. The Handloom Weaver's Lament, which I covered in my last talk, Handloom v Powerloom, and The Middleton Overseer and The Madman. This is the Tyrants of England, which Harland called The Handloom Weaver's Lament. Although some scholars have been quick to claim that Grimshaw was the probable author of these songs, Harland made no such claim, attesting that he'd seen The Madman song on broadsides, and The Handloom Weaver's Lament, as you can see here, was also printed on a later broadside, although that doesn't necessarily rule out John Grimshaw having composed it. Thomas Middleton of Hyde, just 4 miles east of Gorton, based his 1908 book Poets, Poems and Rhymes of East Cheshire on local newspaper archives and dug out a few gems. One was a snatch of a song dating from the Plug Riots of 1848, when a band of armed men marched through Hyde, pulling the plugs from the boilers of the mill steam engines. And apparently, as they marched, they sang, I don't have a tune, I'm afraid, "Come all ye factory toilers and help to plug the boilers. We'll not be tools, we are not fools, although we plug the boilers." Middleton's most colourful account, though, was of John Ashton, a songmaker and ballad seller of the early 19th century, who was known as Jack Straw, from a ruse he employed to evade the law. I quote from Middleton. "He made it a custom to carry a number of pieces of straw. These he sold to his customers for the value of a ballad and then made a free gift of the ballad to the purchaser. 'Buy a straw off me and I will give you a song,' was his street cry." A portion of Jack Straw's wares consisted of songs he had composed himself, though again the texts are lost and the memories of the elderly provided only fragments. They included topical pieces, including one on a strike in a local factory. Jack Straw was something of a Luddite, as apparently. Another on the fair, the fun of the fair at nearby G Cross. A noted wit with an appetite for drink and a loose relationship with money, Straw was known for his aphorisms, often remarking that it would take two people to rob him, one to put money in my pocket and the other to take it out. So there, we've just about come to the end of what I have time to present to you today. My survey of songs, political and comic from this area in South-East Lancashire and North-East Cheshire in the early 19th century. And thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Brian. That was excellent. Thank you. As always, is it right? You're working on a book, aren't you, of radical singers and songs. Is this going to be in the book?
The book originally started out centred around John Stafford, who I talked about last time, but I thought it would be, it would broaden out things a lot and also include a lot of information that I feel hasn't really been properly dealt with before, including the account of the John O'Grinfield ballads and put that in to give us a broader context of the musical environment in which John Stafford was writing his songs, because as I told you last time, he based one of them specifically on John and Grinfilt. So I think it's good to go into all of that as well. I feel that some of the historians who've dealt with it have got a bit jumbled up with the various John and Grinfilts, and some of them seem to think they were all written by the same fella, Joshua Coop, the man with the withered leg. So I just think that needs sorting out good and proper. So that's the plan.
Yeah, I agree, because the John Grinfield is mentioned all the time in snippets and things. It would be good to nail it, as you've just done. But
yeah, I mean, it is very confusing, because you had two pretty well different ballads printed with the same title. So it's kind of understandable that people have got mixed up, which is why I preferred The Poor Cotton Weaver as my title.
Yeah. Okay, any questions? Nobody's got their hands up. What's the matter with you people?
I'll bludgeon them into submission.
That's right. Because they can only ask a question if they can use the Lancashire dialect.
Hey, that's not right.
Yeah, I won't even try it. No, we don't have any questions. But thank you, Brian. That was great. Everybody knows where Brian is if you want to email. Oh, John Baxter has his hand. Hi, John. Hi, John.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that, I mean, that was really good and great. And I've been looking at I Mean to Get Jolly Well Drunk, which was also collected from the same Delft resident, Beckett Whitehead. And that's clearly written for the halls, but it has an element of radicalism to it. And there are figures in the Northwest, like Joseph Gagan, who ran the halls in Bolton for a long time. That sort of radicalism leaked into the stage music hall songs a bit. I wondered if you'd looked at that. You talked about songs being performed at wakes. You mean like wake week fairs and things like that?
Yeah, that's right. Sorry, finish your question, John.
Yeah, it was just where were the songs performed? Were they performed on stage, or was it in the sort of local amateur concerts, or where do you have a feeling for that?
Well, the mention of Wakes Week, I mean, that specifically applied to this fellow, Joss Coop, and he was a pub performer. So I think he would just, Wakes Weeks were chosen because there'd be lots of people in the pub, and that would be where he would find his audience. I think that the thing that I thought might overlap a little bit with the kind of thing you work on is that account of this fellow Alexander Wilson having got his manuscript in his hand, and he sees the famous performer going past the doorway of the shop and waves his hat and says, "You've got to do this one." And apparently he had a crack at another well-known stage performer of the time, but that the second one said, "Well, I think it's very good, but you know, don't call me." Mm-hmm. So there was some kind of an interface. No doubt there is more to be looked at. I was very interested in I Mean to Get Jolly Well Drunk when we had a little online discussion about it. I think this kind of radicalism was very much mainstream. The more you read about Lancashire during this period, even, you know, quite late in the 19th century, there were a lot of people who remembered Peterloo, even if it wasn't during their lifetimes. It had acquired this iconic status, and people felt this great sense of hardship, and also this kind of iconic status of the handloom weavers as well, who, although they were dying out by the second part of the 19th century, were still seen as this repository of independence and of a strong political spirit. So all of that is, you know, highly interesting. And yeah, I might have a chat with you about it sometime, about the possible interface with music hall, although I am really sticking mostly to the period up until 1850. I should also say, before we move on, about Beckett Whitehead. I mean, I think McColl liked to present him as being this simple weaving bloke, but he was really an interesting chap. As I say, he was self-educated, but he was made a fellow of the Royal Geological Society of London because he was such an expert on the local rock formations in the Pennines near where he lived. Quite a lot of the hand weavers and the working class people in the 19th century were like that as well. They were experts on entomology, some of them, and geology and so forth. But Beckett Whitehead You know, McColl, at least in one of his early drafts, claimed that he was a former power loom weaver whose father was a Chartist. I mean, Beckett White had actually wrote an autobiography, which was never published, but it lies in the local museum in Upper Mill. And I've looked at it, and he didn't know his father. He was brought up by his mother. And he did know his grandfather, who would have actually been more likely in terms of the time period to have been a Chartist, but he mentions nothing about that at all in his autobiography. And he wasn't a power loom weaver either. So I think there was a certain amount of myth-making going on there.
Yeah. I mean, I think that I know that I Want to Get Jolly Well Drunk was written by a professional songwriter, but those people had to be close to their audience. It doesn't mean that they weren't infected by the radicalism or would use the radicalism in order to sell the songs. So there's an interesting overlap there in it for me.
I think we've got to move on. Thank you. Because we've got Martin still to go. So thank you again, Brian. That was really good, as always. Okay. Thank you. We're going to move on to Martin. And if you've ever heard me say, as many a person of my age, I know I was that soldier. You'll know where it comes from when Martin's finished. Hello, Martin.
Hello, Steve. I'll share my screen and get going, shall I?
Please do.
Oh, before I do. Beginning.
Don't forget the sound. It was there before we started. There we go.
Okay.
All right, we're seeing it, but not in full screen. Yeah, that's good.
Good. Okay. Well, a few years ago, I bought a copy of bought a copy of a broadside from a line of editions that's fascinated me for many years. And today I want to tell you about my search for the story's origins and describe the way it's appeared in print and other formats over the years. A lot more years than I had expected. And this is the broadside in question. The printer was James Catnack of Seven Dials in London. It's 37 by 24 centimetres, a bit smaller than A3. And I sent you a copy of the text before the meeting, so you'll know that it tells the story of Richard Middleton, a private soldier in the 60th Regiment of Foot. He's arrested during a church service in Glasgow because he was seen to have been handling a pack of cards. He's taken before the mayor and explains how the symbolism of the card serves him as both a prayer book and an almanac. His explanations are believed and he's set free with a loaf of bread, a piece of good cheese, a pot of beer, and a piece of money. Now, the broadside has a round number, V922, but it's a story or recitation rather than a song, and folklorists describe it by the Arna Thompson tale number, AT1613, with the title Playing Cards Are My Calendar and Prayer Book. Now, some of the older ones among you, like Steve, may be thinking this sounds like another story that you've heard, and it's likely to be this recording that you're thinking of. Now, I've a bit more time than I had on broadside day, so I'm going to play the whole thing for you. And it'll familiarise you with some of the phrases and ideas used in the versions you'll hear about later.
During the North African campaign, a bunch of soldier boys had been on a long hike. They arrived in a little town called Casino. The next morning, being Sunday, several of the boys went to church. A sergeant commanded the boys in church, and after the chaplain had read the prayer, the text was taken up next. Those of the boys who had a prayer book took them out, but this one boy had only a deck of cards, and so he spread them out. A sergeant saw the cards and said, Soldier, put away those cards. After the service was over, the soldier was taken prisoner and brought before the provost marshal. The marshal said, Sergeant, why have you brought this man here? For playing cards in church, sir. And what have you to say for yourself, son? Much, sir, replied the soldier. The marshal said, I hope so. For if not, I shall punish you more than any man was ever punished. The soldier said, Sir, I have been on the march for about 6 days. I had neither Bible nor prayer book, but I hope to satisfy you, sir, with the purity of my intentions. And with that, the boy started his story. You see, sir, when I look at the ace, it reminds me there is but one God. The deuce reminds me that the Bible is divided into two parts, the Old and the New Testaments. When I see the tray, I think of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And when I see the four, I think of the four evangelists who preached the gospel. There was Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And when I see the five, it reminds me of the five wise virgins who trimmed their lamps. There were 10 of them. 5 were wise and were saved. 5 were foolish and were shut out. When I see the 6, it reminds me that in 6 days God made this great heaven and earth. And when I see the 7, it reminds me that on the 7th day God rested from his great work. And when I see the 8, I think of the 8 righteous persons God saved when he destroyed this earth. There was Noah, his wife, their sons, and their wives. And when I see the 9, I think of the lepers our Savior cleansed, and 9 out of the 10 didn't even thank him. When I see the 10, I think of the 10 commandments God handed down to Moses on a table of stone. And when I see the king, it reminds me there is but one king of heaven, God Almighty. And when I see the queen, I think of the Blessed Virgin Mary, who is queen of heaven, and the jackanapes is the devil. When I count the number of spots on a deck of cards, I find 365, the number of days in a year. There are 52 cards, the number of weeks in a year. There are 4 suits, the number of weeks in a month. There are 12 picture cards, the number of months in a year. There are 13 tricks, the number of weeks in a quarter. So you see, sir, my pack of cards serves me as a Bible, an almanac, and a prayer book. And friends, the story is true. I know I was that soldier.
Wink Martindale took the deck of cards into the UK pop charts in 1959, twice in 1960, again in 1963, and finally with a reissue in 1973. But he wasn't its creator or the first to record the piece. That honour goes to T. Texas Tyler, who took Deck of Cards into the US charts in 1948. Tyler was an evangelical Christian. He later became a minister. And his creation is reported to have been based on his discovery in the 1930s of an old printed text, the Soldier's Prayer Book. He recognized its potential for a meaningful performance and recast it with the soldier serving in the Second World War. Several other artists recorded the story, and it's been revised for each of the many conflicts that the USA has been involved in since. And it's also been the subject of several parodies. But let's return to my broadside. It has 2 good illustrations. On the right, Richard Middleton can be seen with his cards in the church, and on the left, he's explaining the symbolism of them to the mayor of Glasgow. Dating the broadside is helped by the fact that the soldier says that among the cards, the king reminds him to pray for King George. Catnach started printing in London in 1813, and the last King George, the 4th of that name, died in 1830. So the broadside was probably printed between those 2 dates. The title was included in Catnach's 1832 catalogue. If you search for a version of The Perpetual Almanac by Catnach online, you'll find several copies like this one. This has the same header and woodcuts, but with a decorative border of playing cards. Another important difference is that the monarch for whom prayers are sought is now Queen Victoria, who came to the throne in 1837. So this edition must have been printed after that date. There's a new element that's been added to the story in this version of Catnach's broadside. The mayor, quite correctly, if somewhat pedantically, challenges the soldier on his statement that there are 365 spots on the cards in a pack. His answer was, "I grant it," said the soldier, "but as I've never yet seen an almanac that was thoroughly correct in all points, it would have been impossible for me to imitate an element exactly without a mistake." Now, the mayor accepts this rather flimsy explanation. And that challenge and the reply is a feature of all but one of the Victorian editions of the story from English presses that I've examined. And that challenge about the year also appears in the two American editions of The Soldier's Prayer Book or Dick and His Pack of Cards that I've seen. At this stage, I'd seen examples of 16 broadside ballads and a couple of chapbooks, all having Richard Middleton as the hero of the story. The earliest was 1776, and the youngest about 1890. I had, however, come across a reference to a version recorded in a manuscript in the Hampshire Record Office, written by a farmer's wife, Mary Bacon, who lived near Alton in that county. In her book, Mary Bacon's World, Ruth Facer reported her findings about the manuscripts. It's a ledger which contains the financial and operational records of the farm, originally compiled by Mary Bacon's uncle, but later maintained by Bacon herself. She included a lot of other personal information, such as recipes, cures for both humans and animals, and notes on the books she'd read. Her entry for 20th of April 1762 is a story concerning a pack of cards. And this once again features Richard Middleton in the city of Glasgow. The monarch to be prayed for is George III, and there's no challenge for the number of spots being 365. This is certainly the same story, but it seems to have been copied from another unidentified source, so must be older than 1762. The aim of my investigation turned to finding the earliest version of the story. In one of the volumes that Sabin Baring Gould gave to the British Museum Library, I discovered a broadside with the title, A Pack of Cards, A Complete Almanac. Here, the protagonist is... not a soldier, but a nobleman's servant named Jack. He's denounced by a fellow servant as being a great gamester and is forced to explain why he always carries a pack of cards with him. He tells his employer that the cards serve as his almanac and prayer book and explains the symbolism of each card. The nobleman points out that he's passed directly from the queen to the ten without mentioning the knave. Jack says that he would rather not have described the knave because it reminds him of the informer. Convinced of Jack's innocence, the nobleman fires the informer, who dies soon after, and the following epitaph is carved on his grave. "Stay, reader, and piss here, for it is said, under this stone a sly informer's laid. If heaven be pleased when mortals cease to sin, if hell be pleased when villains enter in, or earth be pleased when it entombs a knave, sure, all are pleased. The rogue is in his grave." There's no printer identified on this broadside, but the use of the long S and the style of the woodcuts suggest middle to late 18th century. Refocusing my internet search with keywords like servant and nobleman in conjunction with cards, 10 other versions of the Jack and his master version of the story were found in 18th century chapbooks and other publications. The epitaph for the informant is to be found in all but one of these versions. The form of the story appeared alongside the military strain until the middle of the 19th century, though the invitation to piss on the informer's grave has sometimes been softened to suggest that the reader might pause for a moment. An expanded search led to a small article, A Tale of a Pack of Cards, in Poor Robin's Jests or the Complete Jester, in Early English Books Online. The article begins, "A precise gentleman kept a servant that was a great player at cards, who was complained thereof to his master by one of his fellow servants," and so on. Frustratingly, the second half of the text is missing, even though the next page is numbered correctly. But it's clear from what we have, however, that this is the opening of a Jack and his master version of The Playing Cards Are My Calendar and Prayer Book Story. Poor Robin's Jests was published in 1666, so this version is significantly older than the editions I had previously encountered. And though it's incomplete, it is an indisputable relative of the later versions. Then a reference in the literature to an earlier jest book, A Banquet of Jests, published in 1630, led me to another story called simply Of Card Playing. In this short tale, we have a country parson who's been living well and who enjoys a game of cards in the evening. A Puritan justice and a diocesan official disapprove of his lifestyle, and at a public meeting, reprove him for his behaviour. In his defence, he explains his interpretation of the cards. The ace expresses the unity that should be between man and wife, the deuce, the love that ought to be between neighbours, and the tray shows that if two of his parishioners are at odds, they need a third to make them friends. The king reminds him of his allegiance to his prince and sovereign, and the queen reminds him of her sacred majesty and the reverence belonging to her estate. The knave puts him in mind of either of his two accusers. So the justice and the official were answered, and the plain, honest parson, for his jest's sake, both applauded and excused. Of card playing can be considered a third form of the story. It's very simple and missing several of the attributes of later versions, so I hesitated before including it. It does, however, contain a form of the knave challenge, which became a regular feature of both the Jack and his master and military strains. But the case for the inclusion of card playing is strengthened by another clerical version, A Tale of a Pack of Cards, which is to be found in the Delectable History of Poor Robin, the Merry Saddler of Walden, published in 1680. This runs on very similar lines to that above, but in greater detail. Not many ages since, a parson of a country village was accused to a committee that he was a great gamester at cards, being so addicted thereunto that he would oft-times play on Sundays. The committee, thus informed, sent forthwith for the parson to answer his accusation, who, receiving the warrant, made no excuses or delay, but with all haste he could, made his appearance before them, with whom also came the informer to justify his accusation. Being thus met together, the committee began to school the parson, that one of his calling should be addicted to such vice as to be noted for a common player at cards. "Indeed," said the parson, "I'm so far from the same that I do not know what a pair of cards meaneth." "Sir," quoth the informer, If you please search his pockets, I believe you will find a pair there at this present, for he seldom goeth without such tackling. Whereupon the committee commanded his pockets be searched, and they found a pair of cards there indeed. But the parson denied them to be cards, saying, they may be cards to you, but to me they are an almanac. And being demanded how he could make it appear, he answered thus, and so on. Now, both Poor Robin's Jest Book from 1666, mentioned earlier, and The Delectable History of Poor Robin the Merry Saddler of Walden have been attributed to William Winstanley. The version in the latter has elements of card playing from 1830, but several phrases are identical to the Jack and His Master version in the 1666 publication. I've not found other examples of the clerical version, perhaps I should say not yet. The National Folklore Collection of Ireland contains a large quantity of folkloric material, much of which is in the Irish School Collection, a remarkable venture by the Irish Folklore Commission from 1937 to 39, when 5,000 schoolchildren were tasked with collecting folklore and traditions from family, friends, and locals. The result was 40,000 exercise books containing over 500,000 pages. These books have been digitized and deleted. Details of the location, the collector, and the informant are recorded, though not always completely. And there's also a transcription for each page, though they do contain several errors, unsurprising perhaps given the scale of the task. The school's collection contains 8 examples of The Playing Cards and My Calendar and Prayer Book Story. There were also another 2 examples in the main collection. And these divided into 5 each of the servant and master strain and the military strain, and are varied in their depth of detail and length. The example on the slide, that from Shauna Kelly, who came from Mayo, is a great piece of Irish storytelling, which you can gather from his opening sentence. Once on a time, long, long ago, and long ago it was, and if we were in that time, we wouldn't be in it now, and that wouldn't be much loss to some of us. But that was the time when the penal laws against the Catholic religion was in full swing, or to be more exact, in or about the year of our Lord, 1765, an Irishman by the name of Richard Lally joined a regiment of the British Army somewhere in England. So you see, it's a military version, but it has some interesting embellishments that I don't have time to go in today, but which will be included in the published version of this paper. Another version of the story from the servant and master strain was recorded by pupils at 2 different Leitrim schools from a Mrs. Dolan, who'd learned it from her father, who'd bought it on a ballad sheet from a fair. She said that he'd learned it by heart and took delight in demonstrating the power of his memory in company. His daughter didn't remember the story quite as well, since on both occasions she left out the king and queen from their usual place, though they were mentioned in the knave challenge further on. When asked to give the correct version, she wouldn't do so without payment. Now, this group of orally collected versions is of great interest and needs more work, as does so much of what I've found in this study. The Playing Cards and My Calendar and Prayer Book Story has been studied before. Writing in 1848, William Chatto quoted the text of the earlier of the Catnach broadsides in full, saying that the story had long been circulating in this country as a penny chapbook. He also mentioned the French book, Explication Morale de Jeu de Carte, published in Brussels in 1768, in which the story is attached to a soldier, Louis Bras de Fer. Though the outline of the story in this book is similar, the explanations of the symbolism of the cards is considerably more complex, and the detail even extends to the significance of the dimensions of the cards themselves. The German folklorist Johannes Bolter compiled a lengthy paper in 1910 titled eine geistliche Auslegung des Kartenspiels, which translates as a spiritual interpretation of the card game. He listed versions in French, English, Swedish, Danish, German, Dutch, Spanish, Portuguese, Italian, and Icelandic. Most of Bolter's examples are from the 19th century, though he does refer to Chateau's article and his inclusion of the story of Louis Bras de Fer. He also mentions the story of Grenadier Richard. This is an even more convoluted explanation of the symbolism of playing cards, wrapped in a translation of the story of Richard Middleton and retaining his name. Coincidentally, the copy of Explication Morale de Jeu de Cartes in the Internet Archive is bound together with a version of Histoire du Jeu de Cartes de Grenadier Richard, published by J.P. Jacob at Versailles in 1811. Bolter said that though he had found no evidence of versions before the end of the 18th century, he was aware of a religious tradition of symbolic interpretation of playing cards going back to at least the 15th century. Some writers have attempted to use Bolter's listing of versions as a system for categorizing the story, but his sample is really too limited to be of much value. In 1939, Edward Wilson published an article in Folklore which reported and commented on Bolter's findings, but admitted that he hadn't had the time to hunt through collections of chapbooks and broadsides. Several articles appeared in American folklore journals between 1952 and 1970. Ed Cray in 1961 gave full texts for some American versions, but also included the text of the mid-19th century version of the Catnach broadside as his earliest version. His most recent version was the Korean War tale by Red River Dave McHenry, which removes the religious element in place of a diatribe against communism. In 1970, Wilgerson Rosenberg wrote A Modern Medieval Story, The Soldier's Deck of Cards. As well as considering Tyler and modern versions of the story, they described a 1967 field trip during which they heard a Baptist minister deliver a sermon that he was renowned for, in which he chanted a form of the deck of cards. This example, and some of those given by Bolter, shows that this story was more than an entertainment. It was an expression of the Christian faith of the storyteller and his audience. Over the last few months, I've collected a set of 67 examples of the playing cards on my calendar and prayer book story, divided into the 8 groups that you can see on the screen. I've also identified some of the main characteristics, other than the date, that are common to most of the variants within each group. Most of the Jack and his Master variants are set in London, for example. A particular King George is sometimes nominated, but it's no surprise that the American versions do not mention a king, though a couple of versions from the Irish Republic in 1938 do. Jack is the usual name for the servant, and Richard Middleton is named in the great majority of the military versions. The epitaph appears only in the Jack and his Master group. The knave challenge is ubiquitous apart from the 20th century American versions. The challenge to the spots adding up to 365 appeared in Queen Victoria's reign, and as in most of the 19th century military versions, but never in Jack and his Master. I found 3 confirmed cases where a report of the story was linked to the possession of an item of street literature, as in the example I gave of Mrs. Dolan's father. As well as the printed and oral sources, there are a few examples of the story having been written out by hand because the writer wished to record it for their own purposes. In some cases, this was recorded in a journal, such as the example mentioned earlier by Mary Bacon. The Reverend John Tomlinson recorded a much abbreviated version in his diary on the 20th of April, 1717. Tomlinson's version seems to be based on the Jack and His Master strain, as is a version in a note from about 1800 in the papers of Lady Charlotte Schreiber in the British Library. This latter appends the epitaph, but in the polite version. While the first two examples appear to be shortened versions given from memory, this last appears to be the copy of a version from cheap literature. I recently bought another manuscript, which is a good handwritten copy of the Catnach broadside with which this study began. It's dated August 1834. The writer of the manuscript clearly had access to a copy of the broadside and yet felt it necessary to make a fair copy of it. I've not analysed the symbolism of the numbered cards used within the different versions of the tales. Some other writers have attempted this, but were doing so on a small number of samples. It would be an interesting exercise, but I will probably decline the opportunity. My classification of the examples into groups, while helpful in preparing this account, could doubtless be improved. When this project was started, my expectation was that the earliest version of the story was likely to come from an 18th century source. To have found that it's very nearly 400 years old has come as a welcome surprise. That it was in oral circulation in Ireland in the 1930s is a great tribute to the story's enduring popularity in a predominantly Catholic country. This was also the time when T. Texas Tyler claimed to have discovered the text that led to his pack of cards and a whole new life for the story, also in a religious context. We don't know what Tyler's source was, but the story was current in joke books of the time. An example is The Religious Card Player, which is to be found in the 1915 joke book Comic Songs, Funny Stories and Recitations, published by Max Stein in Chicago. The pack of cards was being reported as recently as the Gulf War of 1990-91. No more recent references to it have been seen yet. It will be interesting to see whether a religious story like this ceases to be enjoyed or even understood in an increasingly secular society. So thank you for listening. I'd be pleased to try and answer any questions that you might have.
Yeah, thank you, Martin. Excellent stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Those of you who are at the broadside day, we had a follow-up paper. The next paper on the day was from two of our colleagues from the Czech Republic, where they told us all about how it was current in 20th century in the Czech language, with tramping girls, which I think they meant by hiking rather than that they were tramps. There's obviously a hell of a lot more to be found out about this here thing. And so Conrad's got his hand up. Conrad? You're muted again. That's it.
There.
Yeah.
Well, I want to tell you that story is alive and well. You're sitting there at Thanksgiving and having your dinner. You've got your bluegrass song coming on. It's been very much grafted onto the bluegrass stations and playlists. One version or the other, all the way from Wink to the other end. But what happens at our dinner table is just this. Every year the song comes on and everybody just gasps. Oh no! Then that hostility goes away. And then everybody listens politely and enjoys the structure of the verse. So it is still going on. And the name of Wink Martindale, do you know who he did? What he's done in later life?
Oh, I didn't
read that. Very prominent guy, game show host.
Right.
He's been five shows. He might be still kicking, but he's on several shows. Very well known.
Thank you, Conrad.
There you go.
I wonder where he gets his name Wink from.
I used to know that. I looked him up one year wondering what happened to him. You know, you go, he's got a Wikipedia page. Somebody can look it up.
Right.
My computer's like sluggish today.
Thank you, Conrad. Any other comments or questions? No? Well, I think you'll agree, ladies and gentlemen and others, we've had a great two papers today, both of which will be published, hopefully, by the Ballad Partners in the not-too-distant future. And thank you to the two speakers. A round of applause for our speakers today. And we'll see you again on the 19th of May for a continuation of the same song, different song discussion from Steve Gardam. Thanks for coming. Have the rest of your day.
Hi, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.